We have reached that stage of the year, I suppose, or at least of the month, when our very good friends from Spence Clark come to join us. Of course, we have Claudia. Good morning, Claudia. Are you overseeing? You're an overseeing role today, are you? Good morning.
Good morning.
Your tan's looking good. Have you been to Tarifa recently?
Not yet. I was actually in Madrid the weekend.
You Taylor Swift, yeah?
No, Taylor Swift, I think, is this weekend.
It was last night.
It was last night.
Yeah, the Spanish news. She's doing two nights.
Because my daughter's going with her friends, but it's not my sort of... I'm a Rocky, remember?
No, this we know. This we know. So, AC/DC in Sevilla was last night.
No Taylor Swift for me, please.
I was watching Telecinco last night, and it was just crazy. The Swifties, I think they call them, or the Swiftettes. And also joined by Alicia. Alicia, a Taylor Swift fan?
Yes.
Right, okay. So thank you for joining. Now, today, on today's show, 952-78-4000. On today's show, Alicia, the partner in charge of the Spence Clark commercial, of the Spence Clark commercial department, comes to talk to us about one of the most frequent queries they receive from foreigners. I hear that many want to move to Spain, but will continue working for a foreign company, and they want to know how to deal with Spanish income tax and social security formalities. Alicia.
Thank you, Yales. It's a pleasure to be here to talk about this very interesting subject. As an introduction, my years of experience, professional experience, shows that many foreigners get fined because they get this wrong. The internet helps, but it is not reliable. And we even find that advice given by some professionals can also be wrong, also from the UK, not only from Spanish advisors. So today we are going to talk about the income tax and social security issues that involve people moving to Spain to work for foreign employers. We will also cover the self-employed working for foreign clients.
Now, I said before, we've got Claudia with us today, who's coming not just for moral support, and to make sure that I behave.
But a little bit of moral support, but yes, you know, Spence Clark is we're growing and we're divided in departments, and although Alicia is the head of commercial, I'm the personal, the head of the personal tax, we always like to work as a team, and it's true what Alicia says. I totally agree. There's many advisors in Spain who give back bad, very, very bad advice, and especially to do with international issues. And because we write many articles in our website, about many subjects, we do receive many inquiries, and many inquiries are about what Alice is going to talk today.
Okay, that sounds interesting. So, what should people living in Spain? And if you're working for a foreign employer, where should people living in Spain and working for a foreign employer be registered?
Yes, as Claudia said, we usually have to work together because when we receive the inquiries from personal tax, it is also involved my department when they are autonomous or self-employees out of Spain or they are employees. So many of them believe that you can live in Spain but continue to pay income tax elsewhere because the company they work for is based on another country. Also, it is very common for foreign companies to automatically deduct income tax from salaries and that's it. And this is usually incorrect. So it is very important for people to know that people must pay tax and social security in Spain if it is their country of habitual residence. This is regardless of where the employer is based or where the work is done.
So you can't say, oh, well, I'm working for a British company.
It's incredible. You know, the rule is super simple. If you're living in Spain, you must pay your tax here. I would love Giles to live here and not pay tax, but I don't know. This is an absolute rule. We keep on repeating it, but, you know, people ignore it. So there are exceptions, of course, when you submit your income tax declaration, but as a general rule, you must submit your declaration in Spain.
Yes, and it is also some exceptions for social security, depending how much time are you here or if you have been sent to do some kind of work for a branch of your foreign company. So it always needs a specialized advice over this matter.
Okay, so the first step, I think we can agree, is to consult an expert advisor. Find out the tax, what your tax residence is and whether or not you have to register in Spain. Claudia has also already explained this issue in other programs. It's something we tend to go back to. So let's start from here. Let's say I already know I am or will be a tax resident in Spain this year. What is next?
Yes, yeah, so as Giles just said, very important to find out if you're resident or not. Generally, of course, as we always say, there's many rules, but the most important rule is that you spent more than 183 days. So if you arrive in the middle of the year, so at the end, after July, probably there's nothing that you need to do.
Yes, but this applies whether you will be employee by a foreign company or whether you will be self-employed with foreign clients.
Yeah.
So this is first the first step, but the second is to know if you are allowed to work in Spain. This is automatic if you are a non-resident citizen, but not now for other foreigners.
Yes, like us British, you mean, basically, yes.
Yeah, so if you are not, it is first. The second step is to get your working visa and residency card.
Okay, so I understand that. So let's assume that I might be a resident, as I expect to be working in Spain for more than 6 months.
First of all, even if you are not going to be tax resident, you must either have private health insurance or a foreign country social security. It is a document named A1 in uh-huh. Spain, and it is a document that you can ask in your country where you are resident to have covered social security when you are moving to Spain.
So let's assume that I will be living and working here more than a few months. When do I become a tax resident?
Exactly. Then, if you arrive before the end of June and you are staying until the end of the year, then you will be tax resident for the whole year. And this is very important to point out, that it's the whole year.
The whole year?
Yes.
Okay.
This means that you will pay Spanish income tax on your total worldwide income for the calendar year. If you have paid taxes before in another country, then you will have to pay in Spain as well and then ask for the repayment in the other country, probably. But we will have to find out your special situation to set you up. If you arrive after the end of the year, in the middle of the year, you will probably not be tax resident for that year at all. And usually just became resident the 1st of January. But it is very important that you seek advice before, because if you are already self-employed and you plan to stay, you should be registered from the first day you arrive, although you are not going to be resident until the 1st of January.
Okay.
Yeah, and something that I want to add that's important is that Spain does not recognize partial residency. So if you arrive in April, you are not tax resident from April. You're always tax resident for the whole year, from January, okay? Because Spain doesn't recognize partial split years. Always a year. Once you're resident from January to December.
Because in Spain, it works the calendar year. It is different than in the UK.
Many people arrive in May and they think they're going to pay taxes in Spain only from May. They don't. Even if you were not here in Spain from January to May, you have to pay taxes for your worldwide income from January.
So ideally, you should be arriving the 1st of July to get that whole 6 months, or the 1st of January, or just on January to get that whole. So that would be the perfect date.
Yes. Yeah.
And presumably, and I'm sorry I'm going off, but yeah. That would be, it's going to be the M720 again with the worldwide assets. Are we going to go back there?
Oh my God. Not yet. It's gone. Okay. Until next year.
Ladies, right. So let's assume. Oh, blimey. I still wake up. I wake up screaming. I don't even go on the road if it says 720 anymore. I don't get off the road. So let's assume, let's assume that I already have my work permit and I know I will become an official resident of Spain. Mm-hmm. I know I must pay taxes here. Let's also assume that I have a company in another country and I'm already paying taxes in the other country. I don't want to pay tax twice, so what's the right thing to do?
Well, first of all, having a company in another country is especially a complicated situation, and you will certainly need expert advice, because if the company has no place of business or employees outside of Spain and you are the sole director and employee, you have a real problem, because from your residency, when you became resident, it is directly linked to your company. So it's probably that your foreign company will be treated as a Spanish company, so the corporation tax will be paid in Spain in case of review. So it's quite logical, really, if you think, because if the company is nothing more than your personal business front and you live in Spain, then Spain should have the right to tax it like a Spanish company.
Okay.
Otherwise, everyone in Spain will be sitting up foreign companies to avoid Spanish tax.
That was a lot, yes. That was the 80s. Yes. I remember that.
I emphasize that Spanish tax law states this explicitly. So it is not something I am making up. When I explain this to people, many just don't believe it's true. So they just ignore this advice. So the question then is whether the foreign company is really necessary. If you are running the business from Spain, it may be better and a lot cheaper to simply register personally as self-employee. But we understand that people usually work through a company in the UK because they have a very good scheme between dividends and pay, but it is not working in Spain in the same way. So this is why we always ask our clients if they really need the company. It may be that the foreign company is truly necessary for branding, marketing, and other reasons. But in this case, then, what we recommend is the shareholder to be registered as a self-employee, because if you are resident in Spain, you must pay Social Security here, so you should be registered as a self-employee. And then invoicing the foreign company at least the 75% of the profitability of the company.
Right, okay.
Okay, this way, at the end of the day, you are transferring the profits to Spain and you are being taxed for this profit, so the tax office will not be interested to tax your company. But the accurate way is just to find out if it will be interesting to just liquidate the company and keep working as a self-employee in Spain. And also, being self-employee and paying Social Security in Spain, in this case, there is no need to pay Social Security or pay on salary on any foreign country.
Okay, so that's a pretty interesting situation. If I'm the single shareholder in the company, but what happens if there's more shareholders? For example, if the other shareholder, okay, and I'm not just doing this to confuse, if the other shareholder is resident in the foreign country, or if they all move together to Spain, what's the system? What's it say?
Yeah, the system has been developed over many years and works well and has survived formal tax inspections without problems. But I emphasize that the scenario I have described only applies in the case that there is no real business activity in the foreign country and everything is managed from Spain by the shareholder. Otherwise, it is a different strategy this need. If there is more than one shareholder and the other works in the same country as that of the company, it will mean that the business is not only being handled from Spain.
Right.
So the risk of the company being considered a Spain company disappears. Okay?
Yeah.
But if both shareholders move to Spain, as I said, they have to apply the rules I explained, invoicing their company at least the 75% of the profitability. And also, it's typical, as I said, that they want to work as in the UK, splitting the earnings between pay and dividends because it is efficient there, but it is not in Spain. And in Spain, this salaries, this invoicing the company by self-employee is also tax efficiency, so it is not be worried about this efficient in the taxes.
Yeah, because many directors come and they think that this strategy that they have in the UK to, you know, the minimum 14,000 and receiving all the dividends, if they continue with that scheme, they actually end up paying more tax in Spain. So it's hard for them to change their mentality
sometimes.
Because
at the end, they have to declare all this income in the personal income tax declaration when Claudia do this. Yeah. They rent that and then they have to pay here the difference taxes.
So it's something bright for the UK, but it doesn't work in Spain once you become resident.
Yes,
so they must speak with Alicia about that change. Yeah.
As I know from personal painful experience, don't try and outwit Hacienda. They will get you. And also, because there used to be the thing that said the advertising campaign said Spain is different. When it comes to company law, Spain is different.
Yeah.
Now, I'm going to use one of my favourite words. I mean, there's two of my favourite things to say. So, we've already explained what to do with company shareholders. But what about employers working for foreign companies? And can they get the nomad visa? Yes, which is my favourite word. And start teleworking here. What then? Tell us about the nomads.
Teletubbies, no?
Teletubbies, yeah. There is... digital nomad visa.
Yes. Well, this has become very common. However, many believe that having obtained the nomad visa, they don't need to do anything else. And this is not the case. The nomad visa allows non-EU people to work in Spain, but if you work in Spain, social security still needs to be paid in Spain. And probably income tax too, unless you are only going to live here for a few months and you are not becoming resident. But if you are going to be employed by a foreign company, then your employer must register in Spain as an employer to pay social security and employee income tax in Spain. A lot of employers shy away from having anything to do with the Spanish systems. Such fear may be natural, but it is not logical. We look after many foreign companies. With Spanish-based employees without any problem at all. It is essential, it is true, that the foreign company checks, with the advisors, to make sure it will not have unexpected Spanish tax obligation, such as VAT or corporation tax filing, because they, in reality, have a permanent establishment here. But this is something that we have to review in detail for each case. But having an employee in Spain is regarded as having a Spanish work center. And this requires the foreign company to register in Spain, and it is not a difficult thing to do.
It's not a difficult thing to do.
It's straightforward.
It's straightforward, but it's only because you tell them, and many the owners of the company get scared. It's only to be able to register and pay the social security and income tax in Spain, but they're not going to pay corporation tax or anything.
If they don't have any business here, it is just an employee working center.
That's it.
But the services is provided to another country. There is no problem.
What about setting yourself up as a self-employed contractor?
Yes, this is the alternative, but it is a tricky one because to be contractor, it is working as well, but needs to be set up properly with a special contract in which it is specific, very detailed that you are not working as an employee. You are not working under the working hours established for the company and other things.
You can be digital nomad and autonomous though, can't you? That's possible, I presume. I don't know. We don't know. We'll think about that. I'm just.
No, you can. You can use it. Yes, you can.
Yeah.
But the nomad visa allow you to work in Spain. It is like a permit of work, and also give it to you a benefit of using the 25% of vacant scheme tax in case that you became resident and then you have to pay personal income tax here. Mm. But you can also use the Nomad Visa just for a few months.
Okay.
So don't need to become resident and make things more complicated.
Okay, so let's try, because we've only got 8 minutes left.
Okay.
So if this has got through to me. One, if you're self-employed or a shareholder of a foreign company and you move to Spain, you must register in Spain as self-employed to pay social security in Spain. Two, if you're just an employee working for a foreign company and move to Spain to permanently telework, your employer should register for Spanish employment purposes, or it might be possible to set you up as a contractor. That's correct, yes?
In a nutshell.
You have got that right.
Our job is to go through all the opinions. To all the options with our clients and figure out what works best for them.
Okay. In these situations, how do social security contributions work in Spain? Deep breath.
Yeah, this is the complex one. The last reform about the social security is a new system called the Escriba reforms, named after the government minister who created it. It has tried to make the self-employee contribution similar to the employee's one. So an employer will normally pay around 31% of the employee's annual salary, up to around 60,000 euros gross. The employee pays about 6% on top of this. But over these 60,000 euros of salary gross, the employer and the employee pay nothing more. So compared to other countries, at least for the higher paid, Spain can actually be cheaper.
Yeah.
But for the lower paid, Spain is often more expensive than other EU countries, or about the same. The system charges social security contributions based on the net income of the self-employed person. In this case, up to about 70,000 profit this year. The self-employed pay monthly contribution based on net income brackets, costing from 230 to 540 monthly, and this will be gradually over the next 8 years, with the lowest bracket become cheaper and the highest bracket become more expensive.
Yeah.
So if you would like to find more information in our website.
Okay, so what do we get for our social security payments?
This is very important because for both the employee and the self-employee, the contribution provide income during illness, maternity, paternity leave, and retirement pensions. The more you pay into the social security system, the bigger your state pension, and the Spanish system is quite generous with benefits. To summarize, as self-employed individuals, if you would like to receive a generous monthly pension, you can opt for different ways of savings, private pension schemes, and including paying more to social security. So it is a choice to split your savings. But if you have chosen to go through the minimum mandatory contribution based on your net income, you will receive the minimum pension, which currently is around 15,000 euros per year in the future.
Okay, a lot of people just think that Social Security is good for nothing but just medical cover. So what else does the Social Security give us?
Well, for normal employees, the Social Security provides unemployment benefits, income during illness, maternity and paternity leave. And also, all this covers to your dependents. And since this reform, the system for the employees, the benefits are almost the same. So it is true, but be aware, most of the benefits are linked to the contribution that a person pays into the system. So it is fair. The problem is that for self-employees, it is usually complicated to receive the same net income when you became ill, because if you are in a bracket of net income for 6,000 euros, you are paying 540, but give you the right to receive 1,700 monthly if you are ill or for future retirement. So usually self-employed people keep paying the minimum, and then when they are in retirement age, they receive the minimum and not your usual net income, which is 6,000 euros. So to receive a big amount, you should pay more. And this is something that not usually is worth it for the self-employee.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And if there are also agreements with other EU countries as well.
Yes, it is important to point out that all the social security contribution, yes, you pay here, it's considered to sum up in when you became retired in other countries. So it is also.
We've got 3.5 minutes left to talk income tax. Good luck. So.
Well, income tax for self-employees, it is simple, but the problem with self-employees is that they have to pay, submit more taxes. It is not just to pay the 20% of the net profit on quarterly basis, but also they have to submit VAT, they have to submit probably withholding tax because if they have relation with other professionals. So at the end of the year, they have to submit more than 21%. Tax declaration. Mm-hmm. So this make things a little more complicated because they have a lot of work when a simple employee only have to submit one tax declaration annually, the personal income tax declaration, and that's it.
On top of monthly social security payments, they've got to do quarterly and other tax returns as well. So it's an interesting path you choose being self-employed in Spain.
It's not easy if they want to do it on their own, let's say.
They
always need some help.
Talking of help, to get more on this, and the articles on the Spence Clark website are brilliant, well done, because they're not just...
Thank you.
Because they're very, you know, I like well-written articles, and they are. So, hello.
Not just about this, becoming self-employed, it's also a problem about the responsibilities. And it is something that, it is an unlimited responsibility, looks like, but it is not. There is now a law which reduce the responsibility if you register properly, if you are becoming a self-employee, which is the law is empresario. It is to establish as empresario responsabilidad limitada, so to limit your responsibility in cases
so that when you owe money, they don't personally take your assets.
Yes.
So there is something similar like a company, like a limited company. The self-employed people can also have something very similar.
And there is an article about that now on the website.
Right. Okay. I've got 1.5 minutes left. Where's the website?
www.spenceclark.com. And send us an inquiry. We have a free estimate of income tax, many articles, and we also have guides about anything to do with Spanish tax.
Fabulous. And I said digital nomad, which is my favorite word, and my other favorite word, the only time I get to say it when you're around, is grandes fortunas.
Which is huge cigarettes.
Alicia and Claudia from Spence Clark, thank you so much for your time. Honestly, you did so much work for this, so I'm really grateful because it's tricky. Go check out spenceclark.com for that and everything else that you need in the world of tax and advice and just general living in Spain.